It is Tennessee and it's Arkansas. 7:30 Eastern Time's the kick in Fayetteville. We're going to cross it over today with Locked On Hogs to get the inside scoop about the Razorbacks right here on a Thursday, Locked On Vols.
You are Locked On Vols, your daily podcast on the Tennessee Volunteers. Part of the Locked On Podcast Network, your team every day.
Hey, what's up, everybody? Locked On Crossover Edition. I am Eric Kane with Locked On Vols. He is John Neighbors of Locked On Razorbacks. You can follow him, John Neighbors Show, on the X. You can follow me at underscore Kaner. We are free and available wherever you get your podcasts. We're a part of the Locked On Podcast Network, where it is your team every single day. All right, big time showdown coming up this weekend. Tennessee on the road at Arkansas. Over the course of the next 30 minutes or so, we're going to get some season storylines, injury report. We're going to take a look at the quarterbacks, the running backs, the defenses, and overall predictions to get you set for kickoff, Tennessee and Arkansas. So with that being said, John, kind of what's your season storyline so far for Arkansas? 3-2, 1-1 in Southeastern Conference play.
Yeah, I mean, it's pretty much good, but not good enough, or bad, but just bad enough. Like, it's how it's been. They once again continue to find ways and interesting, unique ways to lose games and not play well. I know the competition starts to get better as the year goes on and you get an SEC play. But Razorback fans, they're not surprised by it. And I even hate to put it this way, but they should be 5-0. They really should. They should be undefeated going into this game. They should have beaten Oklahoma State on the road. They had 650 total yards offensively, doubled up Oklahoma State, but just dumb mistakes at crucial times cost them the game. They should have beaten Texas A&M. You could say that about pretty much every game down there in Arlington, because it seems like Arkansas always loses it, but they had some good things going. A&M's not a good team, but they made crucial mistakes, and A&M took advantage of it. So it's weird because Arkansas fans feel they're capable of winning games, and they may even feel like they're capable of winning against Tennessee. Maybe not most, but some. But because of how dumb they are at times and making terrible mistakes, no one has any confidence in winning. So they're a competitive team, but just not a clutch team that's high IQ in moments where it matters the most.
Yeah, and you know, for Tennessee, it's kind of been so far so good. Not a whole lot of adversity has been faced with Tennessee so far. Give credit to the Volunteers in that regard. Going on the road at Oklahoma, had to change the game plan a little in the second half because you were down two starting offensive tackles. So there was kind of that, but you know, Tennessee's been able to run the football effectively against NC State, against Oklahoma to an extent. It took a little while, but they got it going. And then, of course, you had two cupcakes, Kent State, which is the worst team in FBS, and UTC, which is one of the better teams in FCS. But overall, not a whole lot of adversity has hit this team yet. You know, we know it's coming at some point in time. It could happen this weekend, anytime you go on the road. And that's kind of what I was talking with you about on the SEC squad show this week. I mean, it's cliche, like I get it, but I mean, look around college football and see how hard it is to win on the road at points and times. And so, you know, Tennessee certainly can't sleepwalk through this game. But overall, for the Volunteers, it's been a great start coming off a bye as well, where you're trying to get those offensive tackles back and healthy and ready to roll. And maybe this is the game where we see Nico not put it together, because he's been fine. He's not been bad at all so far, but he's yet, because Tennessee hasn't really needed him to, he has yet to absolutely take over a game. And I think a lot of Tennessee fans are hoping that's this weekend.
Well, I was even looking at, you know, the numbers, because I always find it fascinating just to look at ranks and everything. And it's pretty incredible to see Tennessee ranked not only just like top three in the SEC in the major categories, but top five in the country. I mean, number one in the country in scoring offense and number two in scoring defense seems to be a pretty good stat that you want to be really high ranked in. So, but I've heard it from you, and I know I've heard it from other Tennessee people, that they feel like this is going to be the toughest team, or at least the toughest matchup that Tennessee is going to be facing. So I'm curious for you. Tennessee played Oklahoma a couple weeks ago in Norman, and we all know what the meant with Josh Heupel and the connection there. But do you believe that Arkansas is going to be a tougher matchup than what Oklahoma was? Which I know Tennessee won, but what is it about Arkansas you see there? Like, oh, this is going to be tougher than an Oklahoma game.
Overall, I mean, I think maybe Arkansas is not a better team, but I think Arkansas's offense has got the potential to be much better than what Oklahoma's been to date. Now, you know, Jackson Arnold's got benched. Oklahoma, to the last of my knowledge, I didn't watch him last week, but absolutely no run game. Can't figure it out on the offensive line. So it really kind of fed into Tennessee playing good on defense and Tennessee's defensive line and all that. Oklahoma's defense, I thought, was pretty salty. I'll stand by that. I'm intrigued to see as the season goes along how good it is, or you know, if it changes or anything. But I think that's going to be one of the better units Tennessee sees, knowing you got Georgia and Alabama still on the schedule. I think it's going to be one of the better defenses Tennessee sees, you know, all year. So when I look at Arkansas, I kind of flip that. Well, not flip that, because I think Arkansas's got some players on defense. But at least offensively, I think that there's potential for boom at time and bust. And we'll talk Taylen Green and Nico Iamaleava, the quarterbacks, in segment two. But I do think you got some pieces offensively. You got a really good running back, Quinton Jackson. You got, you know, Taylen Green, who can hurt you but also can help you if you're the opposing team. Got some guys on the outside. No true weapon in terms of a go-to guy, but a lot of guys who've got some experience. So I look at Arkansas's offense as, you know, Tennessee thought that the best quarterback it would have seen so far was Grayson McCall. That was not the case. Thought it was going to be Jackson Arnold. That was not the case. Tennessee's safeties, Tennessee's defense overall truly hasn't been tested yet. And again, I continue to say it's coming. Can it be this weekend? We'll find out. But that's kind of how I view it. I think Oklahoma has a better defense, but I think overall Arkansas presents maybe more of a challenge than Tennessee had at Oklahoma.
Yeah, and I love how some Razorback fans try to bring up, like, oh, well, you know, Arkansas has won the last three against Tennessee. And I'm like, okay, that has nothing to do with anything. It's kind of crazy that the last three times that Arkansas has played Tennessee, they've won, but also it was three different coaches. Derek Dooley in 2011, you had Butch Jones in 2015, and then Jeremy Pruitt in 2020. And then this year you're getting Josh Heupel. So I just don't think going into this one that Tennessee should lose this game. Like, they shouldn't, honestly. Even if Arkansas was 5-0 going into this one, I still would bet on Tennessee. I think Tennessee's that good. But I guess the one advantage that Arkansas may feel like they have is they maybe have played tougher competition, maybe defensively a little bit. Yeah. Maybe there's that element to it. But also, Tennessee coming off of a bye week is a little bit unnerving too, if you're a Razorback fan, because you feel like that's supposed to be an advantage to you. But I don't know. It's not an advantage to Arkansas, I can tell you that. They never do that. So that's another thing I think Razorback fans have to be very mindful of, is Tennessee's not only coming into town number four, but they're coming into town number four and rested up and been planning for this game for the past 2 weeks.
Yeah, no doubt about that. I think if this game were to happen last week, you know, coming off that emotional win for Heupel, I don't know if you watched the game, but I mean, yeah. Tennessee, and credit the defense for Oklahoma, and Tennessee had two backup offensive tackles in there, and it was a bad day for them. And so you got away with two strip sack fumbles. You got away with Nico not getting hurt. And so Tennessee was like, all right, well, we finally got the run game going. Okay. Defense is playing lights out. And I mean, Heupel was caught on camera talking to Nico on the field saying, hey, I pull back. You know, we're going to ride our defense. And that's what good coaches do. So I don't want to say it was all Tennessee's decision, because Oklahoma kind of forced that. But, you know, for the most part, I think, you know, Tennessee's kind of dictated the way that it's wanted to play offensively so far. And, you know, back to the bye week anyway, that's where I was going with this. I think if this game was last week, huge trap game for Tennessee. It still kind of is, don't get me wrong, but like, huge trap game coming off that win with all the emotion and everything, and then heading into this next spot in the schedule with Florida, Alabama, and so on and so forth. But I do think it helps Tennessee tremendously to get those tackles back and healthy, and we'll talk about that here in a moment, in a second actually, and to, you know, just kind of get ready to roll in this one. Injury reports so far. I know the SEC will come out with you know, injury reports last night, tonight, tomorrow, and 90 minutes before kickoff. But kind of, where's Arkansas right now in terms of injuries? Anything big and glaring?
Well, what's been unfortunate for them is Patrick Kudus, who preseason-wise was one of their best offensive linemen. He's been out, and he's not playing this year. Like, and I wish that people would just come out, a.k.a. Sam Pittman, and say that he's not. But he's not going to play. And so that's been, without, as far as the big season picture, that's been in the biggest hurt to him. But the secondary's been pretty banged up for him. Jalen Braxton, who is their best defensive back and has been pretty much all season long, he's been out for the past couple games, though. He did not play against Texas A&M, and he did not play against Auburn. Now, luckily, I guess Arkansas didn't win A&M, so maybe not luckily for them. But either way, both quarterbacks were really bad, so they didn't really have to rely on him too much. But he is coming back for this game against Tennessee, which is going to be huge. The other one's Hudson Clark, which, if people remember Hudson Clark, it seems like he's been there for 6 years, because he has. He's just a guy that's really solid. He's not going to play in the NFL or be some, you know, big-time guy, but he's just been that leader and been a really solid safety for Arkansas. And he's been banged up. He was dressed out against A&M. He's been banged the past two games, was dressed out, did not play. And Sam Pittman didn't really make it sound like he was going to play in this one either. So we will see, but that does not bode very well for Arkansas in the secondary, because you know, Tennessee is a really good team, really good offense, and you got to have all the pieces out there that you possibly can. So those are kind of the biggest ones right now. There are some guys that may be banged up. Luke has the tight end. In fact, the tight end position is pretty banged up. Luke has a preseason all-SEC tight end, has been a no-show this year. And he's been playing, but he's just been a no-show. People kept wondering, what in the world? How do you have this guy that's so good? Where's he at? Well, he's been dealing with back injury, and we all know how tough it is with a back. So he has gotten worse with it, and Sam Pittman alluded to it a little bit. So him, Ty Washington, both tight ends, maybe banged up in this one too. So that's another thing. Arkansas is just not good enough to overcome a lot of those injuries. They don't have the depth there. But besides those guys, though, it seems like, at least on paper, you know, we never know, it changes. It seems like Arkansas is going to be fairly healthy going into this one.
Yeah, it can always change. Even with injury reports now, it feels like it can always change. I referenced it a couple of times already, Tennessee's offensive tackles. Two different situations. John Campbell, the right tackle, seventh year in college, by the way. So, again, you talk about lifers in college. Started his career at Miami. He's been here the last 2 years. He's dealing with a knee issue to where, like, he can't have surgery right now. We're going to miss the entire season. He can play, but it's a pain tolerance thing. So, like, he'll start and he'll play 20 to 30 snaps, and that might be all you get. It's a really weird situation. It's unfortunate for him and for Tennessee, because it's kind of like you have half a starter. So, you know, he'll play and he'll start probably, but, you know, he might not play the entire game. On the other side, it's Lance Hurd. Lance Hurd's been dealing with an ankle injury, a big transfer portal addition from LSU this offseason, you know, former five-star, all that. He played the first two games, did not play the Kent State game, did not play the Oklahoma game, and then had a bye week. So, you know, 3 weeks, you'd think that ankle's going to get ready to roll. And so we assume at this point, at the time of this recording, that he's going to play. But, of course, we'll be looking out for that one. Jordan Thomas will appear on the injury report. He was the starting nickelback for Tennessee, but he's been out for the year since suffering an injury in camp. And those are the big ones. But, of course, you know, we'll pay attention as we go along. Want to know about Taylen Green, quarterback for Arkansas. Want to know about Nico Iamaleava. If you're an Arkansas fan, we'll talk quarterbacks. We'll talk running backs. I think both these teams have two good quarterbacks, two good running backs. And we'll look at the defense when we come back right here on a crossover edition, Locked On Podcast Network. This is Locked On Vols and Locked On Razorbacks. Hey, NFL fans, you can start the season with a big return on FanDuel. It is America's number one sports book. So when you get a hunch in the middle of the game, you can check out the latest stats, view the live play-by-play, and so much more on the same page where you make your bets. You'll get started with $200 in bonus bets guaranteed when you place your $5 bet. That's over at FanDuel Sportsbook. It's America's number one sportsbook. Talking NFL, we had that great deal with YouTube TV that we're telling you about leading into September. You know, the first part about September. College football's here. I think yesterday was the first day or the last day without some type of football action until you get to like the month of December, which is incredible. So always good plays for college, for NFL over at FanDuel Sportsbook. Tennessee and Arkansas, you've got, you know, over here on the screen, Tennessee's a 13.5 point favorite. That totals at 60.5. Put some coin in your pocket, play over FanDuel Sportsbook. It is America's number one sportsbook. FanDuel is where you can make every moment more. Hey, we'll go back into a crossover edition, Locked On Vols. I'm Eric Kane with John Neighbors of Locked On Razorbacks, Tennessee and Arkansas, 7:30 Eastern Time, 6:30 local on ABC, coming up in Fayetteville this weekend. Kind of tease it a little bit. Quarterbacks, you know, it feels like everybody in the world's heard about Nico for a couple of years now. Taylen Green, the transfer from Boise State, getting the starts or being the starting quarterback for Arkansas. First, tell me about Taylen Green. I think he resembles, and don't roll your eyes here. I know you love to roll your eyes. I think he resembles the game of Jalen Milroe. Now, Milroe's much better, okay? Like, I'm not saying they're the same guy, but he's long. He's kind of big. Mobility, escapability, all that type of stuff. He's, you know, from what I've seen and from what I see on paper here, kind of boom or bust a little bit, feast or famine. He'll make some plays, but he'll also help the defense out a little bit. What's it been like for him this year, his start, and obviously address those comments from Sam Pittman on Monday of this week saying he might have a confidence problem.
Yeah, he's got so much upside. I mean, I don't know how old your audience may be in some cases. Some people may not remember him, but Matt Jones used to play at Arkansas back in the early 2000s. And he was ahead of the curve. He was ahead of his time. He was 6'6 and 240 pounds. And people don't remember, he ran a 4.37 playing quarterback. And that's kind of the element that Taylen Green has. I don't know if he's that fast, but he's got that long stride to where just one step for him can change the entire pocket. And he can really make teams pay, because one of the things that I remember hearing always about Matt Jones, and Taylen's got a little bit too, is sometimes defenders take bad angles at them because they don't look like they're moving as fast as they actually are because of the stride. And so it can be pretty tough if he gets to that outside. And
that's the second time I've heard that this week, by the way, the bad angles, because it doesn't look like he's moving that fast, but he is.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. That's part of his game that's such an important thing. But the problem is he doesn't have the arm to go along with it right now. He made one of the best throws I've seen him make all season long against Texas A&M this past weekend, where he was on the run and threw it to Isaac Tesla for their first score of the game. I think it was the third play of the game that they ended up doing that. But that's been it. When his offensive line's got to help him out. His offensive line really struggled last week. And that doesn't help a guy that's, as you mentioned, being rattled or being, you know, kind of going crazy a little bit. That hurt him. And so he's got to build that trust back. But even when there's been time he's had time in the pocket, he still hasn't made the reads. He hasn't made a good accurate throws. He's just not an accurate quarterback right now. And that's alarming, you know, if you're going up against good defense. So they got to find ways to get him confident, make the easy throws to set them up for that, let the yards after catch do the work, but also reutilize those legs. Because if him and Jaquin and Jackson can get going with the, you know, whether it's the RPO or just, you know, any sort of breakdown and coverage and take off running, to me, that's going to be Arkansas's best chance at this in this game offensively, because I just don't have trust right now in Taylen Green making the throws that he needs to make.
Look at Nico Iamaleava on the other side. I know that other college football fan bases are tired of hearing his name, because you heard it for 2 years before he even set foot on campus. And then he was the backup last year, and everybody was like, well, you're paying this guy all this money, why isn't he playing? And now it's here. It was a very long and anticipated buildup. And through four games, again, a couple of cupcakes in there, but man, nothing that we've seen from him has been, you know, disappointing or surprising or anything. I mean, he's surprising in a bad way. He's made some throws where you're just like, man, goodness gracious. Like, how are you fitting that ball in that window? And I was like, well, it's UTC. You know, that window is not going to be there against NC State next week. It was there, and he made the throw. And I'm like, oh, well, this is NC State. It's not going to be there against Oklahoma. Yeah, well, it was there. I mean, so far, so good for Nico. He's got, I think, four total turnovers against Oklahoma. Strip sack, you know, I'll put that on the tackle. Another strip sack, I put that on the tackle and the running back. But also maybe that clock, you need to speed it up a little bit. He had two interceptions against NC State. One, he got clobbered. Probably should have just ate the football. The other one was a bad throw. He forced it downfield into, like, quadruple coverage. But, you know, his escapability, he'll make plays with his legs. Accurate thrower. Again, he's hasn't been tested an awful lot, but he's looked really, really good in this one. So I'm intrigued to see these quarterbacks go to work. And, you know, a running back, I want to hear all about Jackson, because I think he's really good. But, you know, Dylan Sampson, you know, Tennessee was off last week, but when you look at the SEC stats, you know, it's Jackson and Sampson kind of jockeying for position, you know, touchdowns, you know, rushing yards, all purpose. Dylan Sampson is a touchdown machine. 26 career games, 24 career games, 26 career touchdowns, or something like that. It's ridiculous. And
it's a good ratio.
He was the third string running back for 2 years. Dude just finds the end zone. He's patient. He's strong. He's tougher than he looks. He's quick. He's a good receiver out of the backfield. He has been Tennessee's best player so far. And, you know, if he can go off, you know, on a national stage, SEC road game and stuff like that, I think that he's going to be more in the national conversations. And without the bye, and if he would have played, you know, all available quarters this year, and Tennessee's starters really haven't because a couple of those cupcakes, I think the stats would be even better. So I think Dylan Sampson's really good on Tennessee's side, and I know Jaquin Jackson has been a welcome addition from Utah. I mean, you had KJ Jefferson leave, you had Rocket Sanders leave. This guy's really, really good, and it looks like Arkansas runs the ball so well where they struggle passing it, and he's a big reason for it.
Yeah, and I mean this in the most complimentary way possible. I think Jaquin Jackson's killed a man, because he has that just – like killer instinct where he loves contact. He loves running you over, and he has swagger to him as well. He's just built like a truck, and he has speed. He's 6'3", 235 pounds. Wow. And he runs with reckless abandon. The issue that he runs into is kind of the issue what Taylen Green ran into is the offensive line has, when the offensive line's got it going, there's a reason why he's still, I believe, leading the SEC in rushing, or at least in the top 10, but he still didn't have a good game last week, and he's still doing that. But last week, it was just because the offensive line gave him no favors. So if the offensive line, which They haven't been great in pass protection. They've been pretty good in run blocking. They open up those holes, it's going to be a huge difference for him. And they're going to go out there and he's going to have success because he's got longevity. He looks for contact. He's the best player on this team, in my opinion. But you got to give him opportunities. You got to open up those lanes because if that hole opens up, he's going to make the most of it. But if Tennessee's able to get back into the backfield and get some tackles for loss, yeah, that's going to be problematic for Arkansas's offense and Jaquinda Jackson if that ends up happening.
Speaking of those TFLs, briefly, I'll touch base on Tennessee's defense. In short, it's been great. I still don't think it's been truly tested, kind of going back to what we thought was going to be Grayson McCall. It wasn't. Thought it was going to be Jackson Arnold. It wasn't. That's why I think Taylen Green's the biggest, opponent Tennessee's faced in terms of the quarterback so far, based on what he's done. Tennessee's defensive line, I know you've heard me say this a million times, they'll play 13 deep. They're all great. They're all old veteran players who have just been in the system for years. And James Pierce hasn't even gotten going yet, which is kind of scary. Tennessee's linebackers, most improved unit on this football team from last year. Keenan Peely, one-time 2016 recruit for BYU. That is correct. Jeez. Yes, he went on a two-year mission. Couple of medical red shirts in there in a COVID year. I mean, it's a weird era in college football. He's been phenomenal. Aaron Carter's been really good. And then Tennessee's secondary, complete new remake of the secondary. Denico Slaughter was a starter here last year. Of course, he's at Arkansas now. I like Tennessee's corners a lot. Jermon McCoy from Oregon State, Ricky Gibson. I think they're really good. I like Tennessee's nickelback. They're playing two guys. They're both young, but Boo Carter is very aggressive. Tennessee's safeties, I still don't know, man. Haven't been tested. I haven't really seen a whole lot of adversity, so I'm a little unsure about Tennessee's safeties. But overall, Tennessee's defense has been really good. They run from that defensive line. They build out that defensive line. And I just think as games go on, not just against Arkansas, but really anybody that's Tennessee's opponent, it's that depth and numbers on the front seven that just get after and just wear an opponent down. So that's a look at Tennessee's defense. Arkansas's defense, tell me all about it. But obviously, Landon Jackson's the guy we got to watch out for.
Yeah, I'm glad Landon Jackson finally broke through. He was struggling for the first four games. Not to say he was bad, but he just wasn't making plays. And I think a lot of that you could probably chalk up to offenses and offensive lines targeting him, double-teaming him a little bit. But against A&M, he finally broke through, got a couple of sacks, and led the team in tackles. So that was really good to see. I'm telling you, the defensive front for Arkansas is surprisingly really good at stopping the run. Now, they're not great at getting to the backfield. And, you can chalk it up to also the type of offenses they played. Because I think especially with Oklahoma State, they get the ball out quickly. So you don't really have that time to get back there. But the linebackers were the group I was concerned about going into this year. Because Arkansas, this is the thing I always tell people. Arkansas lost all six of their linebackers last year. And five of them are still playing college football. So you had five of them just bounce and play for other teams.
Yeah.
And Arkansas was able to get Xavion Sory, the former five-star from Georgia, and a couple other guys, but that was it. Nobody of note. So I was like, man, this linebacker crew is going to be tough. They have been really good. Brad Spence has been great. Xavion Sory has been great. And this team is really hard to run the ball against. Arkansas is a very tough team to run the ball against. And in the secondary, they've done fine. I know if you look at the numbers there and I look at the pass defense, Arkansas is 14th in the SEC, 89th in the country. And people will be like, well, that's not very good. Well, you got to put it into perspective a little bit too. Arkansas in the scoring side of things has done a fairly good job against quality opponents. Like last week, 21 points is A&M is what they scored. I'm sorry, but if you hold an SEC opponent to 21 points, you better win that game.
Yep.
But Arkansas didn't. They held Auburn, who I know is terrible, but they held them to 14 points. So it's like the defense has done a good enough job. They're not great, but they do a good enough job to get the offense in a position to win. The offense hasn't been holding up their end of the bargain. So the defense, though, has been surprisingly solid. Landon Jackson's great. Nico Davie is really starting to come around, another defensive tackle there. I mentioned the secondary players. Nico Slaughter, who I'll admit, Nico, I wasn't too sure about him in the first few games. He was struggling.
Well, it's funny. He's finally playing in position. So get that little backtrack here. In 2020, Tennessee was down like 17 defensive backs because of COVID or whatever. On the road at South Carolina, first game of the season, I think they started in like mid-October or whatever. That was a wild year. True freshman Denico Slaughter starts at nickelback. And then we don't see Denico Slaughter all play defense for like 3 years at all. And then he plays a little bit of safety in 2022. And then one of Tennessee's safety gets dismissed for a few games. He's playing safety. Safety comes back. Slaughter moves to corner. Dude's never played corner in his life. Playing corner makes big plays and everything. And then, but he's, I think he's a nickelback. I think he's that star player. And he never really played that at Tennessee outside of his very first game. Injuries, he's dealt with injuries his entire career. But I think when healthy and when playing in position, I think he's a pretty decent player.
Yeah, and I think that was a part of the problem is they were trying to figure that with him out because of the injuries that they were having and everything. But I'm telling you right now, if Hudson Clark's back and Jalen Braxton's back at full health, then you're going to see a pretty formidable defense. I'm not going to sit here and say that Tennessee's not going to score against them, because I still think Tennessee's probably going to score 30-plus points against Arkansas. But it may at least be not constant big plays the entire time. So watch out for the front deal, because if Dylan Sampson runs the ball effectively, Tennessee's running away with this victory.
Yeah,
but if they hold him in check, that's going to be Arkansas's best chance in this one.
We'll get to some predictions, score against the spread, all that and more, and some keys to victory on an abbreviated segment number 3. We return right here on Locked On Crossover. It's Locked On Vols and Locked On Razorbacks. John, for Tennessee to win this football game, you kind of said it there in the last segment. I mean, Tennessee runs the football so well. Even at Oklahoma, it took a quarter and a half, but Tennessee just kept plugging away. And Dylan Sampson finally broke through, and he had 93 of the hardest earned yards of his life on the road at Oklahoma. Deshaun Bishop, his backup, really kind of got things going in that second quarter. And then the way Tennessee ended the first half, they did 8 plays, 65 yards, whatever it was, and they just rode Dylan Sampson every single play. So even if Arkansas kind of shuts it down a little bit early, Tennessee's going to continue just to peg away, and try to get that thing going. But Tennessee's got to run the football, because everything builds off the run game for Tennessee. The play action, Tennessee and Nico have been great on the play action so far this year, but you've got to have that run game being effective to get those linebackers up, to get those safeties a step slower, to throw over the top. So run the football defensively for Tennessee. If the Volunteers want to win this football game, Jalen Milroe in a couple weeks, like, Tennessee's not going to stop him. They just want to hope to slow him down. I think Taylen Green's going to make a few plays, because I think he's a good athlete, and I think that he's shown the ability to do just that. But I think gap integrity is going to be huge. I think Tennessee's end setting the edge is going to be huge. I think linebackers, when he rolls right all the time. When he rolls right out of the pocket to see that, go and apply pressure and make sure he doesn't pick up 8 on 3rd and 7 or something. So I think gap integrity, watching the quarterback in terms of his legs, are going to be huge defensively in this football game. But I think Tennessee, basically, I know this is so football 101, but if Tennessee plays its game like it's played so far this year, I mean, I'm with you. I think the Vols can, even on the road, can win this by a couple of scores. What are the keys for Arkansas if they want to pull out the upset?
Literally just 2 things, and I know it's simplistic, but running the ball, Jaquinn and Jackson and Taylen Green having success running the ball, and methodical long drives that end in scoring.
Yeah,
because you want to keep the ball out of Tennessee's hands. The one that scares me, I saw this number that Tennessee is number 1 in red zone defense in the country, or in the SEC, and 6th in the country. Arkansas is 16th in the SEC in red zone offense. That's dead last.
Yep.
So that is a huge factor to me. If Arkansas's got to get points on every drive, even if it's a field goal, got to get points, got to move the ball, because if they have, to me, I put the over-under at 5. If Arkansas has 5 or more 3-and-outs in this game, they're toast. It's over. It's done. Tennessee's going to roll away. But if they have less than that, and at least in those drives and scores, they're going to get it done. So keep the ball out of the Tennessee offense's hands and get the rushing attack going. Build some drives. That's the only chance you're going to have. And not turn the ball over, of course.
Yeah.
But that goes for any team. But you got to be able to establish that and feed off the energy of the home crowd. Because Arkansas's worst performances under Sam Pittman the past year and a half have been at home. And it's weird. I don't understand it. And so this is an opportunity for you to feed off of that energy, feed off of the crowd, because it's going to be a big crowd. It's going to be lively. You got to get it done by not making mistakes and not allowing Tennessee to have the ball in their hands the majority of the game.
Tennessee had 2 turnovers at Oklahoma. Tennessee had 2 turnovers at NC State. Arkansas had 3 last week against A&M, 2 against Auburn, 3 against Oklahoma State, and 1 more against UAB, sandwiched in the middle there. The Kentucky model. Kentucky does this to Tennessee every year under Heupel, and you've seen a lot of teams do it. It's try to run more plays, long, methodical drives, play keep away. Sometimes that works. It worked for them against Ole Miss last week, and sometimes it doesn't. Score predictions. How do you see this one panning out? And then from that score prediction, we'll see if who covers and if the total hits.
Yeah, I mean, again, until Arkansas proves me otherwise, I'm going to keep picking them to lose. So, but I do believe this is going to be the classic Arkansas game where they keep it close, uncomfortably close for Tennessee. But don't worry, Tennessee, Arkansas is still going to lose. So it's going into the fourth quarter. I think it's within a one possession game. You know, maybe 10 points, still in doubt. But I think Tennessee makes some plays late and Arkansas makes some mistakes. So I think it ends up being something to the extent of 38-28 Tennessee, something like that. I'm going to take that back because Arkansas is not going to score that much. I'm going to say it's going to be 31-21. Tennessee gets the victory, 10-point lead, and they make the final score of the game to put themselves away in the fourth.
I see Tennessee as the game, kind of similar to what you said. You know, I see Tennessee pulling away certainly at the end just because of the relentlessness of that front. It just wears them down. So far I've seen really good football from Tennessee this year, but you and I have watched enough football of our teams that we cover that, you know, we know that can turn in a minute. Until I see Tennessee give me a reason not to believe they're going to do what they've been doing, I'm just going to, you know, say Tennessee's going to roll, be who it is, and run the football, slow the run a little bit, build explosives off that run, and, you know, play some good defense. So I think Tennessee eventually will pull away and win, but this thing by multiple scores. Give me Tennessee 41 and Arkansas 24. And, of course, that spread is 13.5 for Tennessee. Tennessee would cover that, and of course that total is at 60.5, and that would fly by that total there. So we'll see what happens, man. It's never easy on the road in the SEC, but I'm so glad we're back to playing football and Southeastern Conference. I hated being on the bye last week, and looking forward to being down there in Fayetteville. Man, you going to be at the game?
Of course I'm going to be at the game. I love torture, so I'm going to make sure I'm over there. It's going to be great.
You going to be in the stands or in the press box?
Stands. I'm a season ticket holder. Again, I love torture. I love paying for my torture, and so it's going to be awesome.
I'm going to hit you up. I'm about down a few beers before I go in the press box, so I'll holler at you when I get over there.
Yeah, please do. Please do. We got a tailgate, man. And this is actually Squirrel is the Tennessee player, right?
Yep, Squirrel White.
His uncle, we met him in Arlington, surprisingly, this past weekend, or when Arkansas was down. He was down there, and he was like, hey, he was wearing Tennessee stuff. He saw our Arkansas stuff. He's like, hey, we invite him to the tailgate, so hopefully he comes by. But
that's awesome.
Anyway, so yeah, but you're welcome to come by as well, Tennessee fans. We'll see. Yeah, you're welcome to come by. It'll be a great atmosphere, great weather, great game. So let's hope for the best.
Yep, looking forward to it. That's something I didn't really even mention. Like Oklahoma 2 weeks ago was not quiet, but like it's going to be much louder at Arkansas this week. And that's something that a young quarterback that's only had one true road start, he's going to have to deal with for sure in Nico. So anyway, had fun, man. This is a blast. This has been a Locked On Crossover Edition, Locked On Razorbacks with John Neighbors, Locked On Vols here with Eric Kane. Appreciate you guys, as always, making us your first listen. Make Locked On SEC your second listen here out the door to get you set for the SEC weekend. Locked On Podcast Network, free and available wherever you get your podcasts. Until next time, have a great rest of your Thursday, everybody.